Hello, and welcome to Sobercast, where we provide AA speaker meetings and workshops in podcast format. We're an ad-free podcast, and if you enjoy listening, please help us be self-supporting by visiting Sobercast.com, look for the donate link, and drop a dollar or two into our virtual basket. We hope you enjoy the podcast. Have a great day.
Good evening. My name is Anders. I'm an alcoholic. My sober date is the 8th of January, 1998. And my home group is a men's group called Men Among Men. We meet Thursday night at 8:15 in Copenhagen. And I always say that when I'm asked to speak, because this is two of the most important things for me is I have a sobriety date and I have a home group. And I think my home group is the greatest meeting in the world. And I hope you feel the same way about your home group, because that's the way I want to feel. You know, I want to every Thursday night, you know, during the day, you know, I'm just looking forward to go there and see the guys and hopefully there will be some new guys that we can help and stuff like that. You know, it's just, you know, a guy, I think, a year back, he said very well, he said his week evolves around Thursday, because that's his home group, you know. Every other meeting I go to, I look at as bonus meetings and I go great to go, but I need to be there Thursday night. We are Danes, we love to eat, so we meet at 6:30 and we sit down and we have some dinner and you know, and the new guy who maybe needs to feed a little bit, he can come and actually have some food, and then we you know, tell lies and stuff like that, you know. But I always say, you know, my home group is so important that I need to have a job in my home group. And if they don't, we like get elected to do something, to be the coffee man or the secretary or stuff like that. And if I don't get elected to anything, I steal it. I just steal the work for the coffee man. I go and do the coffee earlier, you know. And that's because, you know, I need to be doing something. And I came here early tonight, you know, like a 7:15 or something like that. And I got asked to do this, like what, 3 or 4 months ago or something like that, and I have made some really good talks in that time, especially 2 nights ago when I couldn't sleep. That was a good talk. You should have been there. But, you know, I've been a bit nervous. I have to do this in a language that I'm not so familiar to, and you know, when I came here early and I was nervous, you know, but I got to put up some chairs and, you know, got out of my, and, you know, that's healthy for me, you know, to do something. So come back to, I'm gonna tell a bit about my story. I always tell my first drinking story, because it's just shows how I was drinking. I was trying to be a part of a group of kids that's a little bit older than me. I wasn't really welcome, but I stole 6 bottles of white wine behind the local food store. We can buy that in Denmark. We don't have liquor stores. And when you are like 13, 14, you know, 6 bottles of white wine will get you into the party. And I remember opening the bottle number 2, and I remember drinking some Bacardi and a strong beer and stuff like that, and then the miracle happened. I remember that I had the courage to talk to the nice girls and the really cool guys. You know, I was being a part of this group that I was, you know, always wanted to be with, and that was what alcohol did for me, and it was amazing. I mean, then I puked, of course, and that would do what we did when you know, 14 and stuff like that. Actually, I puked all the time, but I did that, and next day I woke up and I was okay, you know, and mom didn't found out and stuff like that, but you know, and I was just, this I have to do next weekend. And I bought three strong beers the next weekend. I was going to drink them, but I couldn't get it down. It tasted horrible. Even that, you know, the week before I had stood like this one when I was drunk. And that would sort of show me the way my alcoholism would go, because I didn't like the taste of alcohol. I knew I never drank white wine again. I couldn't get it down. But I went, in a year, I went to vodka. You know, you can mix it up with anything and you can get it down, you know, and it works. And that's why that's how I like my alcohol. You know, I don't drink because I like the red wine. You know, I like I like the effect that it brings. And that's why I start drinking, and you know, it quickly got into drinking every weekend, and then it got into I smoked some hashes and stuff like that. Hi, Adam. And about when I was about 19, I was finished with what I think you call college, and I was just, you know, I didn't know what was up and down, you know, and I was just drinking, you know, whatever. And I didn't realize that the drinking was a problem. You know, I'm a Dane, we drink a lot, and we can even drink in the weekdays and stuff like that, and that would be okay. But I could see that I was using some other stuff that I wasn't so good, you know, and that was a problem. I've always been going back and forward from Iceland because my dad lived there. So, you know, I did my geographical escape and went to Iceland. I thought, you know, this is the guys, this, you know, I hang around with, I need to get away. And the problem is that as you know, it doesn't work. I brought my sick brain with me, and in a couple of months I was at the same spot as I was. But the great part was that in Iceland, AA is much bigger than it is in Denmark. I mean, I was 19 leaving for Iceland. I have no idea that AA existed. But in Iceland, when I was 21, 2 years later, and really scraping the bottom, I was in a farming school, and where we lived at the school, and there was these two guys who was going along us to the parties, you know, and they were driving, they were sober, they were dancing and stuff, and I started to, talking to them, and they were in AA, and I started talking about, you know, my drinking, and you know, and one thing really hit me was when I was talking to this one of the guys, and I said, yeah, but it's so fun to drink. He said, yeah, right, it's fun to drink 5% of the time. You forget the 95% of the time when it sucks. I mean, it's, you know, blah, 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 and trouble and all that. And that really hit me. And actually, when later I got sober and I really saw it through, it was fun 3 years ago or 5 years ago. But what happened was that alcohol stopped working for me. The sensation that I got from, you know, like the beginning when I, you know, could talk to the nice girls and the cool boys. I mean, I still could do that, but sort of, you know, I felt bad inside, you know, and the hangovers, and I'm not talking about the physical stuff that you get used to, but the mental stuff that's really fucked with you. I mean, I was, sorry I said the F word. it's not going to be the last time, sorry. I tease the guys at my home group because I got sober when I was 22, when they come in their late 20s, 30s or whatever. And I tease them and say, you know, didn't you get it? You know, how many times do you have to, you know? But the truth is that I'm a wuss. I'm a wuss. I can't take the pain. You know, I take my hat off people who have been drinking for 20, 30 years. You know, I don't know how to do it because when I was had been drinking for 10 years, I was done. You know, I was at that place that I didn't know what to do because I couldn't drink and I could not drink. You know, it was just like, you know, my skin was, I mean, my head was killing me, you know. And everything, you know, you know, the family problem and the girlfriend problem, jobs and so on, and school problems, you know. It was just, I felt so bad. But I met these two guys and they really, you know, started to wake me up to hey, you can be sober and be happy. Because that wasn't really a picture, you know, that I had, you know. And also I had an uncle in Iceland who had been at that time been sober for 15 years. And I saw him at parties, you know, dancing, you know, and singing, having good fun, good fun. And I saw how he felt, you know. But that still wasn't enough for me to get into AA. I had to, you know, my higher power had to get me in somewhere and, you know, a girl is a good way to get into AA, and I met this girl who was 7 months sober, and after a couple of months, she said, yeah, I don't know if I want to have, you know, with a relationship, and I was about ready, I was giving up, and I had some talk with her, so actually, I went into AA to sort of save a relationship, but, you know, I think it doesn't matter how you get here, the question is, are you an alcoholic, do you need to be here, and are you willing to do what it takes? To stay, you know, and for me, I can say that was what I discovered, and that's what I've been able to do ever since. But, you know, she said that, and I said, oh, whatever, blah, 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 and I went back to Denmark. I've been traveling back and forward since 94 from between Iceland and Denmark, so, you know, don't try to follow me because nobody can. You know, for us, in Europe, it's just like traveling maybe from, what, California to Ohio or something like that, you know. Except you have to fly, but But she sort of, you know, opened some things for me, and in the Christmas in 97, I went to Denmark from Iceland and went to spend Christmas, and my dad was also going. And 2 months before him and my stepmother sent her daughter, my stepsister, to rehab in Iceland. So when I started to open that with my dad, he had went to, sort of an al-anon treatment thing, where the treatment center asked, the family to go there and stuff like that. So he was all, yeah, you know, need to go do it, do that, and talk to the rehab, blah, 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 blah. So he was ready. and it was good. And I drank my last beer, as I said, the 8th of January, 98, and at the airport in going from Denmark to Iceland, knowing that this would probably be the last beer because I was going to quit. I was going to go to rehab and probably AA. And I left sort of like this in the beer and on a bad day. Damn it. Why did I leave the last one? Why? That's not that bad day. I just joke about that. But I went into, actually I didn't went to rehab right away, I went into AA, and it was in the countryside, and it was two meetings a week, and it was the four guys that was been sitting there forever, and I used to say that I didn't hear about a sponsor working the steps and the book and so on, but for like four, six months, but I don't know I don't know if that's true, but at least I didn't get it. If they were talking about it, after 4 months, I went to rehab because I've gotten the idea that rehab would fix me. I don't know who told me that or whatever, but I gotten that idea. And in Iceland, rehab is free. So I got into rehab 4 months sober, and I had to be in detox for like 10 days, and was so fucking boring. And you're not allowed to do anything, watch TV, blah, blah, blah. That was all those sorts of rules. And I was more concerned that the toilet was dirty than listen to the counselors. And then I was supposed to go 28 days out to the countryside, to after rehab, blah, 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 blah. But after 10 days, I realized that they didn't know anything about this. I had been sober for a whole 4 months, so I knew everything. So I just, screw you, I went away. And went to Reykjavik and start going to meetings there and got myself an apartment. I had the same girlfriend who dragged me into AA, and that relationship, I was sober like 5-6 months. She was sober like 1.5 years or something like that, and we were crazy. She wasn't doing anything, any program at all, and I certainly wasn't doing anything at all. And that was, it was screaming and shouting and it was fun. She's happily, I don't remember if she's married, but she has this wonderful guy. She have a kid and I'm married to a wonderful woman, and, we are the best friend today. And actually, my wife sponsored her in another fellowship. So it's great, but, we're good friends. But I at that point, I was starting to feel so miserable in AA that I didn't know what to do. I had been sober 5-6 months, and I just felt like, jumping out of a building or something like that, because I didn't have the release that I remember, because I didn't drink every day when I drank. I drank like in the weekends or sometimes on Tuesday when I was going to have a pizza and, just had one, and then, suddenly it was a little bit more, how it goes. But I didn't, I used alcohol to, take the steam off. And after 5-6 months, I didn't, I built up a lot of pressure. And I remember looking to the meeting, she said, I needed a meeting to go and, let go, and saw there was English speaking meetings there. And I thought, oh, there's will be some other ones from foreigners who know how it is to live on this shitty island. Because, of course it's Iceland's fault, I specifically remember that their bus system is sucked, and I wanted to bitch about that. Because Copenhagen, we have great public transportation, whatever. I was sick. I was really sick. And so I went to the English speaking meeting, and for the first time, something clicked. First of all, they clapped me on the back and said, hey, want you to come to dinner with us after meeting. Why don't you come have a pizza? Because before that, for 6 months, I've been what I call a five-minute guy. I came to the meeting 5 minutes before, and I went 5 minutes after. I never did anything. Maybe I put my cup in the trash can. That's it. And those guys were staying, you know, they went out for dinner, we went out shooting pool, we went to the cinema, we even went dancing, you know. They showed me, and there was an open meeting, their family were coming, and afterwards, you know, some of the kids were coming, and I saw them interacting with each other, you know, with the family, and they were able to get the wrong pizza and not yell at the, you know, what do you call it, waitress, yeah. And you know, and I wasn't able to that at that point, you know, So it was, I saw that something was working in their life that I certainly didn't have. And I looked at the steps and on the wall. I've seen it as of course, in many meetings. But because I'm a wannabe hippie, born too late, you know, I wouldn't follow, you know, a system or stuff like that. You know, I had all kinds of ideas. But I gave in. I got myself a sponsor and I said, okay, let's do this. Actually, I changed the sponsor once because the first sponsor I picked, he took me to strip bars. Somebody likes that sponsor. Sponsor would do that, but he took me to strip bars and then he wants to sell me like a sun insurance thing or whatever, you know, and it got a bit weird. But so I changed sponsor, but that sponsor, he got me to sit down and we looked at the big book. And you know, we talked about the first step, the second, the third step, and you know, he asked me to begin praying on my knees, which was like, what? You know, first of all, praying is like, you know, and praying on my knees is like, I'm raised by communists. It was really hard. The thing that happened was that the first time I went to my niece is I had a problem. I was working with the handicapped children. I had a problem with this girl. She was about 12 or 14 or something. I couldn't figure her out. There was like a school for handicapped kids, and I went on my knees and I prayed, God, could you please show me how to handle this girl? And I went to work and just handled it. I had never there done before. I was just like, it must be, you know, whatever, mistake, or can't be right this. But something tricked in my brain. And since then, you know, praying on my knees has just been, you know, the most wonderful thing. And what I think it does for me is that it makes me humble. It makes me humble to listen to the girl upstairs or whatever. And I need to do that because on my own, I'm screwed. You know, my ideas got me to a loser's club. So I need to have a higher power and I have learned through the years that the higher power talked through you guys. So, you know, I say at a home group, you know, push me. If you see I'm getting weird, push me. Ask me what I'm doing. You know, I'm a social worker. I don't make a lot of money. So if I'm coming with in a big car once, you know, to the meeting, ask me how I got that car. You know, am I taking out some loan on a car I can't afford or stuff like that? Ask me what I'm doing. You know, how I'm talking to my wife, stuff like that. You know, because we need to keep each other accountable because I can lie to myself so fast, you know, but you guys, you can see it when I start, you know, and that's also the important thing to come into a home group because I can stand here. The only guys who know me in here is like three guys and I can really look good and you wouldn't know because you don't know me. But if it's your home group, you know, people know you. And when you go coming and being a bit, you know, they will see it and say, hey, okay, let's go outside and take a coffee or a cigarette or whatever and talk about it, you know. And then we get it out because I'm not always willing, you know, I'm not always willing to talk about it because I like feeling miserable, you know, instead of sitting down and writing a 4-step or whatever, a 10-step or whatever. But I got the sponsor and I started working the steps and it was amazing to write this 4th step and especially sitting down doing the 5th step because then I saw, you know, I have been pointing finger all the time. It's my mom's fault, my dad's fault, you know, those fault, blah, 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 blah. Seeing that it wasn't their fault, you know. I have to change, and I don't have the power to change, but I know how to seek that power that I can change. And the miracle for me happened between fifth and ninth step, somewhere there. I don't know exactly when, but I was walking down the main street in Reykjavik, looking into a bar and thinking, I don't need to be in there. I don't want to be in there. And I feel good about myself at the same time. For me as an alcoholic, not to want to drink or need to drink and feeling good about myself is a miracle. I can't remember being like that. If I felt good about myself, that's because I was drunk. Or at least I had the bottle. And knew in a little while, you know, it's amazing. It's amazed me that, you know, I could get this bottle and I haven't drunk it yet, but I know in a little while everything is going to be all right. I mean, that voice, you know, I still, when I smell hashes, I still get that, in a little while, everything's going to be all right. It's amazing, you know. But that miracle happened for me, and it really clicked, you know, hey, I'm here, you know, I've arrived. And I started to begin to work on my ninth step, and it's amazing experience to get free of that stuff. You know, I especially always talk about one thing is in downtown Reykjavik, there's a place where they rent tents for tourists, and they are stupid enough to leave the tent out in front of the store to show also in the night. And I came by drunk, and if you leave something outside when I come. He's here for the taking, you know. So I had the tent, and it was like 5 years later. I got sober, and you know, I'm still having a good tent. And I can remember that I was afraid of this place, but because where that camera, you know, could I get busted on that? And I went to the store with the tent, and I said, you know, oh, you remember? Yeah. I says, yeah. There's a police report and everything. So I said, you know, that was me. I have the tent. It's a bit, of course, it's torn some places and stuff like that, you know. So you have to fix it. So I gave her the tent. I gave her some money. And I went out a free man. You know, I went out, you know, I as you say, sometimes when I play sports in them, I have to remove the bed from the wall so I can lie like this. You know, that was how I felt. You know, I felt like my hands were up in the air because I've cleaned up. I could walk by that place without feeling guilt. That was amazing, and that's how the ninth step, I talked to my family and former employers and all that stuff. You know, my problem was that when I got drunk, I got clipped. You call it kleptoman, or what do you call it? When you start to steal stuff, you know. I mean, I can't come home from wake up the next morning, and I just have this weirdest stuff at my room, you know. You know. I don't know, and some of this, I mean, I'm still paying to charity, but because some of the stuff, I have no idea. You know, and then I started to working on also on my 10th step and to pray and meditate, which is, it's just a world on its own, you know, it's just a magic. I like the instructions of the big book because they're so simple that you can pray pretty much, you know, make your own. There's good directions. But that's not like you have to do it like that. And I mean, mine has developed. When I met my wife 5 years ago, she's a Buddhist. I started to chant. It's great for me. Before that, I did other stuff, and I have sponsors that look into a candle or whatever. You know, it's so much fun that you can do whatever. And it's so freeing that it doesn't have to be any, you know, specific religion or something like that. You know, it's just. But what I did was I did two things that almost got me drinking again. Once I put my 8 step list in the drawer. Two, I didn't get the 12th, the last step, the 12th step. I didn't get that. I didn't get that I'm supposed to give this, pass it on. I mean, I showed the newcomer the bathroom and the coffee pot and stuff like that, but I didn't get any sponsees, stuff like that, you know. And by the time that I was 3 or 4 years sober, I was so miserable that I was looking everywhere else to fix me. You know, video games, video, girls, you name it, you know, anything that could fix me because, I mean, I just, and I think, I mean, it was so close. It was so close, but I got it. I felt miserable as I never felt before. And the thing that kept me sober was I never stopped praying. I never stopped praying. But, you know, it was like praying, and then, you know, I take my life back. Especially about money and girls. God, you know,
I got that color.
And 3 or 4 years later, you know, relationship after relationship and debts, you know, it was just like, you know. But then I got a new sponsor. We sat down and read the book page by page up loud, which was amazing to see. You know, we read 2 pages, talked about that, read 2 pages, talked about that. And I finally got it that almost every page, at least every chapter says, you gotta work with the new guy. You gotta work with the new guy. For me, it just became a whole new thing, you know, because I was getting bored, you know. I was going to the same meeting, listening to the same people talking about the same stuff, you know. Okay, I hear his story again, you know. But suddenly I woke up, and one of the things that also woke me up was speaker tapes. I started to listen to speaker tapes. And Mark Houston was one of them, but when I listened to Chris Raymer, I got, But with this sponsor, he really woke me up to trust him. And suddenly I realized, and what I do today, I cross the line between going to a meeting because I need to be at a meeting, because I need you to give me something, over the line to, I need to be at a meeting because I need to give you something. And when I started to do that, that's when, you know, I realized, you know, hey, go to the meeting to put up the chairs, make some coffee, or be there for the new guy, you know, got sponsees, you know, sitting down, reading the book with them, you know, taking my very precious time in front of the TV away and going helping this new guy. And it's just, you know, it's exploded how fun I have in AA today. And every meeting is just like, oh, yes, I get to do something for AA. I get to do something for this new guy or the new girl, which is basically when it's a girl, it's like, go to the girls. but it's just, I mean, I don't know. It's like a whole new life inside AA when I realized it, step 12. And that's about the time when I moved back to Iceland, and I went into this men's group meetings, which was a huge meeting. About that time, it was about 140 people each Monday night, and it was so much fun, and it was so great. And I finished up the last of my 9-step. That was also the other thing, you know, pulling out this 8-step list from the drawer and finishing it, because a lot of people, if you ask them, they have 1 or 2, maybe more. A lot of people had it, and I'm really beating on my sponsees to finish the 9-step. You know, they want to go through the steps again, like I did. You know, I want to go back because I don't want to do this shit. You know, and if I always start over, I don't have to finish the 9-step. You know, so, and that's always, you know, there's this money, or there's this, you know, father, mother-in-law, or whatever, the old girlfriend, or whatever that we're afraid of. But you know, and finishing up and knowing that I'm square with the world is an amazing thing, you know. There might be, I mean, I have later found up, you know, remember some stuff, and then I clean that up. But I can only clean up what I can, you know, put on paper today, you know, and remember what I did. And as I said, many of the things I can't do anything about. You know, I don't remember where I stole that thing or that thing, or you know, or that blonde with the whatever. And so, you know, I mean, I can't. But I do stuff like, you know, because of my grandparents, I'm good to older, elderly people, you know, stand up and train and the bus or whatever, you know, so they can have a seat. As I say, I pay to charity because I know I owe amends to the world as a whole, you know, by being a pig. So, but I moved to Iceland, and I was on fire in AA, and a bomb went off. My father got killed in a car accident when I was sitting back at the car, and it was supposed to be a really happy day. We were on our way to the airport to go into Copenhagen to see my sister, who had a kid the day before. Whoa, it's been a long time since I talked about this in public, man. And then suddenly the car is upside down, and you know, my life just. But you know what? It happened 6 o'clock in the morning, something like that. At 3 or 4 o'clock in the hospital, I was pretty much alright. I talked to like a guy who talks to people who is in an accident like that, you know, to help them get over, like a therapist or something like that. And I told him that I was an AA. And he said, oh, then people will understand if you are going drinking now. And I just laughed and said, not in that AA I go to. And the amazing thing was that I haven't experienced that much pain in my life. I mean, my dad was my best friend. Since I haven't experienced that much pain, but at 6 o'clock in the morning, 3 or 4 o'clock in the afternoon, alcohol never entered my mind. Never. I thought about smoking. I quit smoking a month before. I thought about smoking a lot. But I said, hey, you know, my dad dies quickly. He don't want to let me make suicide slowly, you know. So I didn't pick up that cigarette, and I'm glad we bought that. But new alcohol never entered my mind. It was so amazing. You probably, most of you know the story about footsteps in the sand. I mean, wow, I got carried. You know, AA, my higher power carried me through a pain. I can't go through that shit like that sober. You know, I mean, that's a perfectly good reason to go drinking, you know. But you know, I just, somehow, because I think had that happened a year before when I was playing video games, watching video and girls a lot, I wouldn't have made it, you know. I wouldn't have made it. But when I was right in AA, when I was at that spot, and I'm just lucky that it didn't happen a year before. So now I just keep myself always at that spot where I can take everything, you know, just bring it on. Because what if I lose somebody else I love, you know? I don't want to get drink because of that, you know? So I better keep on a spiritual plane where life can happen. And, you know, and there can be so much, I mean, it's so easy to get self-pity or stuff like that. And, you know, but prayer and meditation help a lot, you know? Actually, the accident happened like it was a waiter coming home 6 o'clock in the morning for a job, drunk. And I drove drunk a lot. So for me, that was okay. I understand that. My brother, who's not an alcoholic, he got pissed when he heard that. And he has a bit of resentment about that. But you know, for me, I understand it. But it's just like what I experienced through prayer and meditation with that. I experienced that you know, it comes out like, why me? You know, first of all, my dad died, I didn't. Second of all, should it happen to you or you? You know, why not me? You know, why not me? You know, why shouldn't it happen to somebody else all the time? You know, why not me? And then, of course, I had some resentment toward the guy, and I prayed and meditated on that, and I got a vision of him and my dad above the, this is freaky stuff. If you don't pray and meditate, you won't get this. But if you do, you will get this. I got like a vision of him and my father above the accident site. This is like 2 weeks later or something like that, 3 weeks maybe. And like they're looking down at it. And the guy's coming to my dad and say, hey, I'm sorry, I'm so sorry, you know. And my dad is just like, oh, it's okay, you know, didn't do it on purpose. That's it. And I, you know, for me, if my dad can say that and say, you know, it's okay, then probably I should. I mean, I'm still here. So that's when the bomb went off. I've heard a speaker a while back talk about that when your bomb got off. You know, what happened, you know? Is it divorce, whatever, you know, what happened? Can you stay sober through that? And I'm happy that I did. And also, I talked to actually my first real sponsee like a couple of days later, and he said, wow, he had 2 weeks sober. And he said, wow, if you get through that, you could go through that sober, I believe in this program. You know, what more do you want? You know, what more do you want? You know, like a new guy just saying, you know, hey, this is, I start believing. And he went through the program and I heard his the first fifth step ever. And that's like, whoa, to be able to have a guy trust you enough to say all the, you know, all the dirty stuff that we do and nasty little things, you know, the goats and so on. I mean, it's amazing. It's amazing, you know. And funny thing is that when I listen to a fifth step, I also share some of my stuff because then it, you know, and every time I do that, my sort of, no, you know, it doesn't matter, you know. Okay, so I stole this and I did that and I tried that and you know what, I thought that about everybody or whatever. I mean, most of my thing is just sexual thinking. Never acted on it, but I felt bad because I was thinking sick thoughts, you know. Hey, and I've heard that a lot of guys. Probably girls, I don't know, I haven't heard that, but guys think that. I don't know, you know, I got peace with that. So I, about that time, also got involved with, as Chris talked about, XA speakers, which is, as you said, a website where you can download speaker. And it's been amazing work, because what I do is just basically I download the speaker and listen to it. So I, you know, I have at the moment I have a half hour commute to work, so I get to listen to a speaker, you know, most of the time he's drunk, or her, she's drunk on the way to work, and she gets sober on the way back. You know, it's a half an hour. But it's really great, because then I start my day off listening to somebody else than my own head, you know, and I get to do service work for AA, you know, and it's amazing. And sometimes, you know, the speakers are really, really boring, but that's how it is. But you know, the message are there, you know, and that's good, you know. And also, I don't know if you know this guy, but in Iceland, this is so cool. In Iceland, if you go into the FM band radio, 88.5 speakers. They cut off the last name. I want to tell you, even Bill, when Bill Wilson, they cut off Wilson. But they have a radio that's reading from the big book and 12 for 12 in Icelandic, and then they got English-speaking speakers. I mean, it's just amazing. And the way they started is so funny. It was a guy, he was 4 months sober. Like, he was like, he's like a manic drunk. He does a lot of stuff like that. But he talked, you know, with his sponsor, and his sponsor, whatever, didn't really understand what he was talking about, and he just put up... Actually, started like pirating. He didn't have a license to put on the radio. He just did it. But slowly, he got some other guys involved, and I was also a bit part of it, because, you know, this guy he doesn't finish stuff. He just starts it, but that's okay, you know. I mean, this started off. I got the license. There was a problem, because the Icelandic law, you can only have Icelandic speaking at in the radio, and when you can't translate or speak, that's like silly. But so they got a license anyway, you know, like, what do you call it? What? Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exception. Yeah, of course. Yeah. Also because they used the Icelandic big book, you know, and 12 and 12. And in the beginning, you know, we knew nothing, you know, we put up a DVD player. With speakers on, you had like, what, four gigabytes of speak, and then, you know, you had like 24 hours going, and it kept like going up, and you know, in between. We didn't realize it. But the thing is, DVD player isn't made to run 24 hours, 7 days a week, you know, it just break down. We didn't figure that out. So, I mean, that was a technical difficulties like that, but you know, it's grown and it's gone big, and it's just, I mean, and in the English speaking group I went to, there was a girl who came in through radio, you know. She was sitting, you know, and, you know, crawling the walls at home, you know, and hadn't heard about AA, and she heard the radio, and, you know, she heard about AA and went in, you know. If all that just for her, that's cool, you know. And I want to say, you know, the anonymity is cut out by taking the last names and phone numbers or whatever people give out on the speak. So, and then the convention has been a gift for me to be a part of. The first convention, I've been to a couple of conventions before, but the first convention I got involved with was in 2003. And it was Peter M. and Chris and Myers. And it was like, in Iceland, it was amazing. It was also because it was, I like convention that where the housing is shitty. You know, this was in the back in a book storage room, and the whole, there was like 400 people, and one of the walls was just a big bookshelf, but books in boxes, you know, and these chairs were chairs like this, you know, and it was just, you know, the rough walls, like in a basement and stuff like that, but the atmosphere was fantastic, and a year later, we got Carrie, Adam's wife, Tom Iverster and John Kelly over, and that year we got that was so much fun. We had got the building wasn't ready. It was supposed to be something like where you show cars, so it had like big doors and just concrete all over. And we got it a week before the convention, and we walk in there, and the echo was like, it was impossible to do anything in there. I mean, you sit, you whisper in the corner and just, the convention was about maybe 300 people, but there could be 1,000 in there. It was huge. And we just sat there and, what the fuck do we do? You know, we screwed. We couldn't do. God is good. The weekend,
was a food conference in Iceland. Food conference, they use carpet, a lot of carpet. And one of the guys got all the carpet for free. So we just, you know, carpet the floor, the walls are hanging down, you know, and you know, that sound was perfect. I mean, but Adam, you were there, we used, I don't know how many square feet of carpet. It was like, I mean, we couldn't have bought that, you know, that was a cost, you know, I don't know how, but you know, we just got it. That was a stain here and there, you know, that doesn't matter, you know. And I love that, and how we paid for the rent of it, that we painted the floor for the guy. He wanted floor paint, you know, that's what, and we were, you know, we stood there with a big bottle of paint and painted it, and I'm Danish, and I was just screaming, hey, where's my beer? I'm a painter, I need my beer, you know, some of the guys were getting nervous, you know, I'm just cooling around. Because, you know, that's how workers do in Denmark. We are like half drunk all the time, but now it's getting better. And then I moved to Denmark and I got involved in starting up a conference there, and which also was amazing to remember that we were especially, I mean, Iceland free emission, Denmark free emission. I want to put that out there that it's possible to make a convention without, you know, just the seventh edition that is free to come, and I think that's the way it should be. We were so afraid about the money because we collected some money to pay for the airplane tickets for the guys and to get a room and stuff like that, and we were so afraid not to get in the money. But you know, 5 years later, 10 conferences later, still there, it's running, and it's been great. And you know, we had Chris over we have had some great conferences and always the bug is there, and we always, you know, a bit nervous on Sunday, you know, will we get it in? But you know. What we have to do sometimes is to get a cheaper place, you know, so instead of, you know, the rent, maybe move a bit out of the center of Copenhagen and stuff like that, but you know, it works, you know, and also we ask often our speakers to stay at private homes because we can't afford the hotels, and or some of the speakers have enough money to pay their own hotel, that's fine, you know, that's that's up to them. But you know, it's just been amazing to it's so amazing to be sitting, you know, in the back, seeing a room of 300 or 400 people, and you know you play a part in that. You know, you play a part that people will come and hear the message. It's the same. I mean, it's the same as you putting up the chairs, meeting. You know you are part of being people being able to come and hear the message of Alcoholics Anonymous, which you know, is, I mean, it's so just great. I mean. And all these years, you know, I met my wife 5 years ago. It was after I went through the steps again. I realized that I have to let God take care of this woman problem or whatever, and also the money problem. And since then, I have been with the same woman. I haven't gotten into more debts, which is quite cool. And it's just been amazing. I mean, I think one of the most fun thing to look at in my recovery is how I interact with my wife, because she's the first who get hurt when I don't do my morning meditation and prayers, you know. Then I got screwed up, you know, and she always, I talk about like this, you know. It's so funny because I can come home on a Tuesday night or whatever night, you know, and the dishes are undone, or whatever, you know, she's doing something that I don't want to. And if I've done my if I'm in spiritual, spiritual fits, thank you. If I'm spiritually fit, that won't bother me. I just take the dishes, you know, I clean up whatever needs to be cleaned up. But if I'm not, she's, you know, and that one. And it's so funny, it's the same situation. It's just where am I at in my head, you know. I mean, it's really when I realized that, you know, there's nothing wrong with this world around me. It's me and my attitude. I mean, I need to look at the world, as Chuck says, you know, with a new pair of glasses, because that's me that's wrong with, you know. I had a sponsor time who said, you know, when you're pointing at people saying, yeah, remember the three fingers that's pointing at you, you know. And it's sort of equal like that, you know. I always get into that. You know, self-pity, oh, poor me, you know, because you're so bad to me, the world is so bad to me, and what we're leaving to you is just more misery. But if I instead sit down, use a pen and paper, which is, I mean, the pen and paper is an amazing. I used to do a written, answer the question on page 86 at night, you know, when you were tired at night, the book says, you know, where we are sinful, blah, 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 blah. And I stopped doing that for like 1.5 years ago, And just before I came to the state, like 2 weeks ago, I did a new 4-step, and I was like 80 people I was resentful at. It was just like, you know, I was, you know. And that's what happened when I do that stuff. And it's you know, because I've been doing 4-step, you know, every second year, approximately the 10 years I've been sober. And I've never, since my first 4-step, have so many names, but because I've always cleaned up, you know, in between. And that's when I see, you know, when I answer the question writing and I see the same person 3 days in a row, maybe I should sit down and make some columns. That would maybe be a good idea, and call my sponsor and talk about it and whatever and do, and you know, and it, I mean, it's so easy, but I love to rest on my laurels. I love to be, you know, on the couch instead of doing that or whatever, you know. But I mean, it's always been number one on my character defect list. It's lazy. I'm lazy. I'm a lazy bastard. And my mom always used to say, you know, that I was trying to jump over where the fence were lowest. That's a Danish saying, doesn't translate well, but you know, you get the picture. And you know what? Mom's right. I hate to say it, but she was right. That's actually the 9th step I would like to talk about also. My mom. And it's like, it's not like I hear people, you know, had hit their mom, stole from her, blah, blah, blah. What I did to my mom is that she was lying awake at night thinking where was I and what I was doing. The emotional hurt that I did to her, wondering about how her boy was doing, that was what hurt her. And I sat down with her and there was some sponsor who said that to me. I didn't get that. You know, I was talking about that when I did that. He said, no, doesn't matter. What matters is, the emotional hurt you done to her, and I sat down with her, and I remember because also my mom has done a lot of things I think wrong. You know, I'm a social worker. You know, I've read about this. You know, how to be a parent and stuff like that. And I see. It was about the same time I was reading, especially one book, and I just saw that, you know, many of the things she has done is why I have the low self-esteem that I had. But that's not an excuse to point fingers. So she did what she best she could. But so what I had to sit on my hands and listen. And I said, you know, I want to say sorry about this and this and this and anything else. And then she started. Like for half an hour. And I was just, I wanted to, you know, to say, but you know, but I didn't. And that's the great thing. And, you know, it doesn't matter. I don't have to blame her for low self-esteem or shit like that, because I have a tool how to get out of it, you know. And it's not like it's her fault, all of it. It's, you know, she had a part in it, but you know, what does it matter to blame her for that, you know? She's an old lady. I just leave her alone and you know, and not leave her alone, like, don't talk to her, but leave her alone about that, you know, and just, you know, try to be a friend today and be a good boy, you know. And one of the things is that I start calling her every Sunday. You know, let her know what I'm doing, how I'm, you know, just, you know, blah, 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 I did this week, blah, blah, blah. And our relationship is wonderful today. I mean, I still have stuff, you know, and once in a while, you know, I'm at home, it, you know, makes things that I can feel, but you know, and I get better to when she's walking over my boundaries, she just say, hey, here, you know, stop this, I don't, you know, and you know how people are, but you know, it's just amazing that I'm able to be the I say that I can, you know, today I can be the son I always wanted to be, the brother, the husband, the worker, the co-worker, the guy I always wanted to be, I can be today. I have these high expectations of myself that I wanted to be, but I never got there, you know. But today, because I'm doing this, I mean, I can be there, and it's I'm so grateful that I got into AA. I'm so grateful that this wonderful, wonderful program, I mean, has kept me sober. I see the guys that come in that drink 10 more years than I did, and it doesn't get any better, you know. I'm just happy that I'm a wuss and I got in early, and it's amazing. And the last thing I just want to brag about the Danish AA book, because we have the guts to still have the circle and triangle on our books. Or maybe we are stupid enough not to fear our lawsuit, I don't know.
But it's been wonderful to be here. I love your country. It's the first time I'm here. I'm just having so much fun. I'm going to a road trip with my wife, and we have a five-month-old boy, and Adam's wife Carrie's taking care of him tonight. My wife is down the road at a VA meeting, and it's just wonderful. She's a 12-step program, so you know, when I get fucked up, she tells me to call my sponsor, go to a meeting and stuff like that, and it's good. But I mumble, and then I go do it, but I need to. But it's great. I like when people catch my shit when I'm, off bounds, because I need to be spiritual fit. And it's, I can't imagine I talked that long, but it's wonderful to be here. Thank you.
Thanks for listening. I hope you enjoyed the podcast. Sobercast is ad-free, and we'd like your help in order to keep it that way. So if you'd like to help us be self-supporting by pledging $1 or $2 a month, visit Sobercast.com and look for the donate links. Thank you very much.